Today, let's talk a little bit about Kali and how she nearly danced the universe to death.
I like the fact that she fixed it that way.
Budget! Budget!
Indiana Jones, oh my god. That movie is so weird. What's up and welcome to another Hindu Guy Reacts video. And if you're like,
what?
What Hindu guy? What is this? I thought we'd talk about cartoons and stuff. Yes, you're right. We do talk about cartoons and we also talk about everything, anything and absolutely nothing. And a while back, I did talk about Hindu mythology. I made a reaction video to some Hindu sketches that was made by the mythology guy.
Hi, I'm the mythology guy.
Because I am a Tamil Hindu Sri Lankan and I'm not an expert, but I did study Hinduism for 11 years in school because it was mandatory.
Listen to me, you little maggot. From now on, you will speak only when spoken to. You're about to endure more pain and suffering than you ever thought possible.
Thanks to the mythology guy sharing that video. That video made about 15,000 views. So thank you, mythology guy, and thank you guys for watching it, and thanks to you guys who stuck around. Appreciate you, and I'm here to do another one because of that.
Thank you. You love me. You really love me!
So we're reacting to a channel called OverlySarcasticProductions. They make mythology videos, history videos, Shakespeare, tropes. It's more of an educational channel, but they do have their entertainment spin on it. And it's a quite amazing channel, so the link is in the description below. Go check them out.
I'm gonna go check it out.
We are reacting to a video that they've made that's called Kali Tries to Kill Everything.
Destroy, destroy, destroy!
Before we begin, I just want to say we are doing this for entertainment purposes, but I will be sharing you my personal cultural knowledge, and if you can learn a lot from it, that'll be great too. So, let's begin, folks.
Wow. Who'd have ever guessed that this wasn't a fully accurate portrayal of Hindu worship?
Okay. Quick pause right there. Indiana Jones, oh my god. Temple of Doom, I think that was a movie. Oh my god, That movie is so weird.
Weird or courageous?
Pretty sure weird.
Okay. Weird!
My favorite Indiana Jones has to be One with the Knight. That's the one I actually remember, and also the one with Shia LaBeouf. But I prefer the Knight one more than the Shia LaBeouf one.
Understandable.
But you know those black magic, cultish kind of stuff? Well, they are a part of it in the ruler areas, not in a sense like cults kind of way, but it's more like your local witch doctor shaman type of thing. And yes, they do sometimes do some black magic stuff.
Kali, Suli, Holi!
Holiya? Adu Marwadi pandigai illa?
In fact, it is called Pillisunyam in Tamil, and like ruler areas in India, and also ruler areas here. They're like to do hexes on people that you don't like, curses, and stuff like that. It's a silly thing, it's nonsense, it's not really true.
Oh, come on! Your mumbo jumbo is no more real than a fortune cookie.
Also, these black magic guys sometimes get rid of ghosts, and they even send ghosts after you if you want them to.
Budget! Budget! Budget!
Again, it's all nonsense, it's not really true. But again, that's why I want to say it happens in very rural areas, very uneducated areas, in fact. And that's why this is not a good representation of the mainstream Hinduism. Because in the mainstream Hinduism, we don't do that kind of black magic stuff, hexes, and those kind of things don't exist, actually.
We don't do that! Tell her we don't do that!
Also, sacrifices and stuff. Obviously, there is no human sacrificing stuff like that. Only nuts do that.
They're crazy.
But in terms of animal sacrifices, well, that's a little bit tricky. So in Hindu worship, it's two types of practices. One is Agavam Sarandavu, and the other is Agavam Sarandavu. So in Agavam Sarandavu is basically like your mainstream Hinduism, where there's like no animal sacrifices, nothing like that. That's basically the mainstream Hinduism that overall most Hindus kind of practice. And because of its mainstream appeal, and it also works well with the modern day, and that's why it's more broadly practiced.
Pretty much.
But in Agavam Sarandavu, the type of practices or worship, animal sacrifice is allowed. Chickens, goats, again, this is mostly present in villages and rural areas, in the cities, and overall in the mainstream, it's always Ahom Sardha worship, and that's all veggies. We can make offerings to gods, which all either has to be vegetables and sweets and stuff like that, but no animal sacrifices in that.
We have vegetarians.
So in terms of gods, there are some village gods that are situated in their area, have their own cultural stories and stuff like that, that are kind of okay with the sacrificing traditions. Even Narasimha and Kali, those guys would be okay with the animal sacrificing. But again, only if you're practicing Hinduism through Agavam Sara, the type of worship. But for Lord Shiva, that's a big no-no.
You've betrayed Shiva.
So yeah, Indiana Jones is right when he said that, because, you know, Shiva is a hardcore vegetarian. In fact, there's actually a story where a hunter actually offers Shiva meat. And Shiva knows that the hunter actually doesn't know the proper ways to worship Shiva. And he's only doing this out of devotion. And again, he has no ill will. And again, he didn't actually know the proper ways to worship Shiva. Shiva took the meat because he didn't want to offend him, because he knows that his devotion was pure. So when Shiva took the meat, he started bleeding out of his eyes. Because that meat is filled with the pain of an animal. This is also a story that symbolizes the value of a life and how it causes pain when you actually slaughter an animal to the god that you worship. So it symbolizes that in this story as well. And also, you might be thinking a little bit different, like Shiva is the destroyer of the universe. Why is he giving so much, you know, tears of blood to one single animal? Well, that's the thing. He is the destroyer deity, but his destruction leads to creation. Again, it's part of that cycle.
In the great circle of life.
That kind of happens out of the order of the universe. While you kill an animal and offering to a god, that's more like an unnecessary sacrifice, at least in considered in our custom. So again, Shiva prefers veggies.
I think I'm going to stick with carrots for a while.
We are only 7 to 8 seconds in, and based off that Temple of Doom clip we talked so much about. But before we move on from the Temple of Doom, I just want to give you a quick fact that actually Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom was not actually filmed in India. It was actually shot in Sri Lanka. It's a quick fact, you can actually look that up.
Look it up.
So Hinduism is often called the oldest religion on Earth, a description that actually seems to be true. And because of its antiquity and the fact that it's a synthesis of a large number of disparate traditions and practices from all over the Indian subcontinent, summarizing it concisely in the space of an entertaining intro paragraph is difficult, to say the least. In the broadest, most insultingly simplified terms, Hinduism focuses on how best to live one's life while simultaneously finding a way to escape samsara, the cycle of reincarnation.
It is difficult to summarize, but she's right on that one. Yes, it's mostly about how to live a fulfilling life and also escaping the cycle of reincarnation. So understanding your place in the universe and letting go of all the trivial things in life and becoming a fulfilled soul is the ultimate goal of the soul. So because after you've done all that, you won't repeat the cycle of reincarnation. You would join God, who is the ultimate soul. And you can't really do that in one single lifetime. I mean, to let go of all the things that you need to live through it all.
Get them all out of your system.
You need to live everything that life has to offer. Only then you can become fulfilled. There are some extraordinary individuals in stories have done that in a single lifetime, whether through great devotion or prayer or through ultimate sacrifice. Or, you know, achieving enlightenment.
Lucky bastard.
But for mere mortals like you and me, we have to live through it all and get everything out of our systems before we achieve enlightenment and become a fulfilled soul and be ready to join God, the ultimate soul. In fact, joining God in a sense like you're becoming one with the light, that's how it's relatively phrased in English. It's basically in Tamil, so it's like, Paranjodhi Adevayaka or Paranjodhi Ursirvayaka. So Saivas, the Hindus who mostly focus on the worship of Lord Shiva, which is where I come from as well, and we have a text called the Siva Purana, which has like all the things that you'll be born into as like, you know, every step of reincarnation. And it kind of goes like this, it's like you'll be a worm, you'll be a bird, you'll be a fish, you'll be a man, you'll be a multi-fang thing, etc. Huge list in that text, and we had to sing that on every Friday in school. So like I said before, religion is a must subject in Sri Lanka, and also prayer. We begin every morning assembly with a short prayer, but on Fridays we go to temples. Our school had a temple in our school. We had to sing the Siva Pranam on every Fridays, and then the puja will begin, and then we'll go off and start our studies.
There's also the concept of Maya, illusion, as a source of distraction from one's proper understanding of their place in the universe. And there's also Brahman, which is this sort of ultimate...
So yes, Maya is basically an illusion.
It's fake. It's all for you.
I don't understand.
And the sky, and the sea, everything. It's a set. It's a show.
Like desires and all the trivial things in life. And also not so trivial things in life as well, things that also seem as very important, like family bonds.
But what's real is family.
Which again, is important, but in the cosmic scale, it's not.
But what's real is family.
Not important!
The fact that you're old, the fact that we're all going to die one day, the fact that the universe is so big, nothing in it matters, those facts are who you are. So you're trapped in there.
And also, even your memories, they are impermanent.
Where am I? Who am I?
Because of Maya, the impermanent things in life seem permanent and makes you fixate on them and confuses you.
Nobody gets it. Nothing you think matters, matters. This isn't special. This is happening infinite times across infinite realities.
Including this?
Yes!
The only thing you can kind of consider to be permanent in this universe is your soul and also God, the ultimate soul.
Probably. Maybe.
So you must look past the veil that is Maya. But you also need to look within, because God is also present in you. But you also need to look beyond Maya.
Oh, that's confusing.
This is one of the things that in the Bhagavad Gita, the lesson that Krishna was giving to Arjuna, is to let go of things.
Train yourself to let go of everything you fear to lose.
Let it go!
There's also Brahman, which is this sort of ultimate universal principle thing, which is really hard to concisely define without sounding like a hippie or a cult leader, but it's kind of the unifying principle energy thing of the universe. There's also Shakti, which is a specifically feminine primordial cosmic energy thing that seems to play the same role as Brahman does in the versions that use it. Now, when it comes to the gods specifically, Hinduism has a system that sounds more complicated than it is. Basically, every god is an aspect of that primordial energy universe stuff, and most gods will be specific aspects of other bigger gods. For example, Parvati is the gentle, nurturing, motherly aspect of cosmic universe goddess Shakti, Durga is the warrior aspect of Parvati, and Kali is the pissed-off warrior aspect of Durga. They're all usually treated...
Okay, so small thing here, yes, Shakti is could be considered the primordial feminine energy, and Shiva, for us Saivas, could be considered the primordial masculine energy of the universe, and both combined creates the Ardhanarishvara. The name Shakti, right, the name Shakti literally means energy in Tamil, so power or energy, but Shakti is also a name that we used to call Parvati. Again, Shakti is not another form of Parvati. Durga is another form of Parvati. But Shakti and Parvati are the same goddess. But in this, they separated Shakti as a universe goddess. I don't think that's right here, because for us at least, for Saivas, Parvati, Shakti, and Uma Devi are all the same name for, you know, Parvati. But I get what she was going for here, and the universal female goddess is known as Adibara Shakti, I believe. But I'm not that really familiar with this type where the female goddess, the Adibara Shakti, has great importance than other gods. So correct me if I'm wrong on any of this here. So Adivara Shakti is the grand goddess. She created all the other gods, even the male versions of the gods. And she created the female versions of the gods, who then they married off to the male versions. But again, they are in a sense more powerful than the male gods, and Adivara Shakti is the most powerful goddess. And Adivara Shakti does not have a husband. This is not the case for us Saivas. For us, Shiva is the most powerful god, and there is nothing higher than him. So his wife, Shakti, can be considered an equal, and that's why Shiva has half and half, and they are also both considered the both sides of the same coin, in fact. But again, Shiva is the grand god of everything. He is the Mahadevar. Again, master of reality itself and stuff like that. And this does not mean we don't worship other gods. We do, and it is actually encouraged. But again, Shiva plays a much, or at least he's higher in ranking than other gods. Again, the Trinity still functions the same, like Brahma creates, Vishnu preserves, and Shiva destroys, which leads to creation. But it's also implied that Vishnu and Shiva can, you know, beat Brahma if they want to. In fact, Shiva has actually taken Brahma's head off once.
You're back.
No.
How'd you know his head would grow back?
It grows back.
You might think the creator deity, because Brahma is the creator deity, has more importance. But for some reason, it's not. Again, Krishna is much more important. In a sense, like, Krishna is also considered to be an equal to Shiva as well, because he's the preserver of the universe. Living itself kind of depends on Vishnu. So I think that's why they more focus on him, even though Brahma is the one that breathes life into the universe. But again, he's kind of down below considered in Vishnu and Shiva's sake.
You see, on top there's Don Lino.
Right.
There's me.
Mm-hmm.
And there's regular fish.
Oh, that's me.
No. There's plankton. Mm. There's single-cell amoebas.
Oh, then there's me.
I'm getting there. There's coral. There's rocks. There's whale poo. And then there's you.
That's messed up.
Specific aspects of other bigger gods. For example, Parvati is the gentle, nurturing, motherly aspect of cosmic universe goddess Shakti, Durga is the warrior aspect of Parvati, and Kali is the pissed-off warrior aspect of Durga. They're all usually treated as distinct goddesses, but at the same time, they're also all the same entity, taking increasingly specific forms. One other confusing element to all this is that, because the Hindu gods are kind of fluid and mostly symbolic, their relationships with one another can also be pretty flexible from myth to myth. For example, the general rule is that mother goddess Parvati is the wife of Shiva, the destructive aspect of the Trimurti whose job it is to end the universe. But Kali, whenever she's around, is also characterized as Shiva's wife without this conflicting with Parvati's thing.
So Durga and Kali are another forms or aspects of Umadeviyar, or so known as Parvati or Shakti. But they're all still married to Lord Shiva. But there are gods who does have multiple wives, like Shiva's son Murugan, the Hindu god of war, and also the god of our language, Tamil. I don't know how that goes in hand-to-hand, like war and also language. Now, when you're conquering some lands, also spread the language. That's what the British did. I don't know why Murugan's doing that. So he has two wives, but his father, Shiva, has only one wife.
So now that we've sort of barely, not really contextualized this, today let's talk a little bit about Kali and how she nearly danced the universe to death.
I like the fact that she faced it that way. Let's talk about how Kali nearly danced the universe to death. It's funny because Shiva actually does have a dance that destroys the universe. If you don't know, Shiva is the destroyer of the universe, and he actually does dance the universe to death. It's actually called the Rudra Dandavam. It's also a dance that he does when he's angry. But it's also the dance that he will do at the, you know, when it's time to destroy the universe. Which, I'm not gonna lie, makes me laugh. It is time to destroy the universe. But how? By dancing, of course. Hit that beat.
I have never thought.
Word of warning, there's about 500,000 variants on this story, with this being only one of them. Mythology is fun like that. Please be nice to my comment section. So our story begins with
Okay. Again, sorry for pausing like in very short distances in the video, but I just had to say thank you, Red, from Overly Sarcastic Productions. Yes, there's a bunch of other different versions of the same story, and it varies from place to place. Like she said before, Hinduism is big, ridiculously big even. Mainly because, even in India, there's a bunch of people who speak different languages, have their own traditions and customs and cultures, and the stories vary from place to place. Hinduism is also part of Sri Lanka, and again, our stories kind of differ from other places. But this does not mean that specific stories have their origins, like the Mahabharata was originally written in Sanskrit. But it's also got translated by other authors / sages. I say authors / sages because all the people who write religious texts considered to be holy people who had the grand vision to able to actually speak the tales of gods or write the tales of gods. It actually differs from place to place from the original Sanskrit version, because when different authors / sages wrote it, they sometimes interpret things differently, or they may craft another narrative, they may write on different point of view, they may add on things, they may leave some things out. So people from different places kind of go with their writers / sages story. A good example for this is the character from Mahabharata, Karnan. He is beloved in the Tamil culture. In fact, he kind of differs from personality and also some story angles from the original Sanskrit version. He's been highlighted and been expanded upon in our texts, and also the caste narrative in his story is also kind of heavily implied. And this is due to the facts of the injustices and the social issues in the Tamil societies. So through the mythological story and this character, they kind of highlighted that and expanded a little bit more, and which is a thing that usually religious stories do. And also for Tamils and also some other communities as well, is that that's the Mahabharata version that they believe in. They don't believe in the Sanskrit versions. They believed in that version of the story. And again, it's due to the fact that their own upbringing and stuff like that. This is why you can't really fact check mythology, because you can't really claim a story that they believe in and has more cultural ties to them as false. Because again, it does not present in Sanskrit version, but Sanskrit version is not the version that they were brought up on. The studies again focus on their own texts. So calling one version fake, calling another version not fake is, you know how in comic books we claim it as canon and non-canon or Elseworld and stuff like that. It kind of goes into that territory. But again, we have to be very careful with mythology, because again, this has to do with people's belief more than anything else. So saying that the other version of the story you believe in is wrong, this version is the true, is basically like, you know, Bugs and Daffy kind of ripping off, this is actually rabbit season, or this is actually duck season.
Rabbit season! Duck season! Rabbit season! Duck season! Rabbit season!
It's kind of silly as that, because, you know, historically, we don't actually know Mahabharata actually happened. Hindus believe it actually happened. I myself believe that there could have been a war that inspired the Mahabharata.
Excuse me.
Let's turn up the heat.
Again, you can hate me for this, but that's what I believe. I think it was inspired by some historical events. We don't technically know exactly what it is. Maybe that's the beauty of it, and that's how it's got written into mythology. But for those people who believe as Mahabharata actually has happened, they're going to believe in the version that their own culture told them. Again, this is actually a good thing in mythology, in all mythologies actually. A lot of stories varies from place to place, and that's why mythology is fun, like Red said. You get different stories from the same premise, and that's cool, you get more stories.
More! More!
So our story begins with Durga and the Matrikas, a good name for a band, fighting these dudes Chanda, Munda, and Rakta Bija, along with their obligatory army of faceless minions. Now these guys are Asuras, who are bad guy deities that make a habit of battling the Devas, who are the good guy deities. Rakta Bija specifically—
Okay, quick pause right there, yes. Asuras, or another word for them would be Rakshasas. They are generally the bad guys, but this is not a typical thing. Not all Asuras and Rakshasas are evil. like Vibhishan from the Ramayana. He is a good Asura. Again, being an Asura does not typically make you evil, but most of the bad guys in Hinduism turn out to be Asuras. And also being a Deva does not make you generally good as well. There are some naughty Devas, like Indran, for example. Asuras, bad power-seeking deities, mostly defined by their conflict with the Devas. Yes. This is the post-verdict definition before Agni and Indra were frequently classed as Asuras? What?
Now that's a thinker.
Okay, this is new to me. I always been taught that Indran was a Devar, and also he is the king of Devas, in fact. He is the elemental god of rain, thunder, sky. He's basically Zeus, both in character and also in power.
Hey, how you doing?
Only main difference is Zeus basically gets away with it because there are no other powerful gods than Zeus that punish him. But for Indra's case, he gets punished more often than not. I never knew that Indra was referred to as an Asura, and at least it was never taught to me. But again, historically speaking, Indran has a much older history. In fact, he's older than most gods, historically speaking. So I don't know, but if you know anything about Indra being referred to as an Asura, and also Agni been referring to as an Asura, let me know in the comments below, because I have no idea about this one.
I don't know.
Now these guys are Asuras, who are bad guy deities that make a habit of battling the Devas, who are the good guy deities. Raktabija specifically has a particularly annoying power that makes him significantly harder to manage than the others. Whenever a drop of his blood touches the earth, it pops out a duplicate of him. This makes fighting him extremely frustrating due to his continuously replenishing supply of bad guys. In fact, it's so frustrating that the sheer force of Durga's pissed off facial expression causes Kali to spontaneously manifest out of her forehead creases and start kicking ass. Now Kali is a lot of things, but terrifying sums her up pretty well. As the physical embodiment of Durga's wrath, she's unsurprisingly lacking in chill, and after immediately murdering Chanda and Mundo with minimal difficulty, she starts up on taking down Raktabija, first by eating all of his clones and most of the rest of his army.
So Kali basically turned into Upchuck from Ben 10 to beat this guy.
Gax! Ben!
I'm gonna chew you up and spit you out!
And then by juicing him like an orange.
Man, talk about eating your problems away.
No! I'll give you cavities.
Or juicing them and drinking them away, I guess.
Reed, we really can't go outside anymore. We are-
This, unsurprisingly, kills him pretty thoroughly, and with Kali drinking all his blood before it can reach the ground, he's left tragically cloneless and is therefore dead for real. So with that, the battle's over and the Devas have won. But unfortunately, Kali, as a manifestation of Durga's unstoppable rage, doesn't exactly chill out just because the battle's done. Instead, she starts wreaking widespread havoc, murdering basically everything she comes across and dancing on the bodies of the dead.
Yeah, Kali's like the Hulk. When she gets going, there's no stopping her.
Dr. Banner! Bruce! You did it!
Her victory dance slash murder party gets so intense that it starts threatening the universe itself, at which point the rest of the Devas decide it's time to call in Shiva to sort this all out.
Shiva! You gotta stop your wife! Parvati's right there.
Maybe the red.
Your other wife.
So Shiva surveys the situation.
Ah, I see the problem here. I forgot to take the trash out last night. No wonder she's pissed.
So Shiva surveys the situation and decides that the only way to get through to his scary wife is through a dramatic heroic sacrifice. So he dives under her foot mid-stomp to heroically shield the ground from her onslaught. When Kali realizes she just boogied all over her husband, she bleps in surprise and immediately calms down and stops destroying the universe. Which is good, because as established, that's Shiva's job.
Yes, it is Shiva's job to destroy the universe, not Kali's. Also, Shiva's heroic sacrifice attempt kinda symbolizes the love and respect they have for each other. The slightest form of disrespect is enough to snap Kali out to realize that she just caused disrespect and harm to her loving husband.
Oh, I'm sorry, honey. I'm so, so,
I'm so, so sorry. I just, ha!
But no other thing could have calmed Kali down. But this is not only the one time that Shua was called in to solve other people's temper tantrums. There was one time when Narasimha got out of control. Narasimha is a Vishnu's avatar, or Vishnu's another aspect or another form. Is basically pissed off version of Vishnu. He's half lion, half man. He basically awesome looking. He's one of my favorites. And yeah, he's a very pissed off version of Vishnu. And after killing a demon, of course he was created to kill a demon, he also went berserk. No one could actually calm him down, so they all went to Shiva. Shiva basically took the form of a half lion, half eagle. It's a weird animal. He had to forcefully stop Narasimha because he can't really do the heroic loving husband sacrifice thing with Narasimha, because Narasimha is not Shiva's husband, and basically he won't care that if he stepped on Shiva.
I won't hurt you anymore. No one will.
I'd apologize that more than half of the body of this video is contextualizing Hinduism instead of getting right to the myth, but I don't want to because it's really interesting and I'm not sorry. My description is also very, very inadequate and only covers vague broad strokes elements without addressing any of the myriad forms of regional variation or basically any of the philosophical aspects.
I have nothing but respect for that one guy on Twitter who described Kali as, quote, waifu as fuck. I don't know about that. Yes, she has tremendous love and respect for her husband, but I don't know. I think she's still too intense. I think Durga would be great because she strikes the perfect balance of battle and beauty. And yeah, this is a very courageous fellow, especially on Twitter.
Poor bastard.
This video is the result of a very enlightening conversation with a friend of mine while heckling Temple of Dune for cultural inaccuracies. I think Red did a good job in this video. This story is similar to the one that I know of, so again, great. But like she said before, there are many versions of this story because Hinduism is big, ridiculously big. Hinduism is spread throughout all of India and also outside of India, like countries like Sri Lanka and also some other countries as well. So of course, the story is going to vary because that's what mythology kind of does. Every mythology does that. But that's why I like videos like this. It kind of gives you a spark. It makes you fascinated about subjects that if you're from the West, you have no idea about, and you can go and do your own research. I checked out a lot of Greek stuff after I started watching The Mythology Guy, and also, of course, Always Sarcastic Productions have different mythologies like Hawaiian stories and stuff like that. That also made me, you know, want to check out more stuff and do my own research on it. And that's why I think these YouTube educators / entertainers are brilliant.
It's brilliant, 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 I tell you. Genius, I say.
If you like this video, go check out my other Hindu Guy Reacts video where I reacted to sketches that was done by the Mythology Guy, Hindu sketches in fact. Also, don't forget to leave a like, comment, and also subscribe so you can check out more of my shenanigans.